Good morning to all my dear Miss audiences in this webinar. And so my talk is on tectonic evolution and exhumation of the Himalaya, a low temperature thermochronological study from the Northwest Himalaya. Hope it is audible to all my participants.
Okay. Yes sir, this is audible.
Okay, so this is the topic on which I am going to talk now. So this is this Himalaya is a very important physiographic zone of our India, because it attracts many geoscientists from different parts of the world, also different parts of the world as well as from our different parts of our country also, because this Himalaya provides a good look at the continent collision, and it is the youngest and the highest mountain range that you know very well. And it is the world fastest uplift and exhumation rate. It means that is at 1 centimeter per year. And this rapid exhumation is going on in Nanga Parbat and Namcha Barwar regions of the Himalaya. And also we know that this Himalaya has maximum relative relief, that is around 6 kilometer. And this 6 kilometer relief, it is present in Indus Valley. And also this Himalayan mountain belt is associated with the world's largest plateau, having altitude 5,000 meters. Really, this Himalaya is very fantastic and very nice feature, and it is produced due to orthogonal collision, that you know. This collision means this collision between the Indian plate and Eurasian plate. So this is our Himalayan mountain belt, which extends from Nanga Parbat in the northwest and Namcha Barwa in the northeast. And its width, it ran between the Indus River and Yalu-Sangpu River in the north and main frontal thrust in the south. So this is the geological map of the Himalaya. We can see the different tectonic zone of the Himalaya in different colors. This light blue color represents the Tethys Himalayan sequence, and it extends throughout the Himalaya. Then towards south of it is the pink color. You can see this pink color one. This is the higher Himalayan crest lines. And then towards south of this one is the light orange color. And this is the lesser Himalayan meta sedimentary zone. And towards south of it is the yellow color, which is the sub-Himalayan rocks. And towards south of this one is we have the Indo-Gangetic plain. This white color, this part is the Indo-Gangetic plain. So this is the geology of the Himalaya. And the different the tectonic zones are bounded along their southern margin by different tectonic boundaries, such as main frontal thrust in the south of the sub Himalaya, main boundary thrust in the south of the lesser Himalayan metasedimentary zone, and in the south of this higher Himalayan crestline is the main central thrust, and in the south of this Tethyan sedimentary zone, That is the South Tibetan detachment system. Now we can see, this is the 3D view of the Himalaya, and this part represents the surface view, and this part is representing the cross-sectional view of the Himalaya. First, when we see the cross-sectional view, we can see the different thrusts are present, which are dipping towards northeast direction. And also, we can see all these thrusts, those are merging with the major fault that is called main Himalayan thrust. And this main Himalayan thrust, it extends from the main frontal thrust and below the Himalaya. And its depth, it varies from the low depth near the below the Shivalik, and higher depth below the higher Himalaya and Tethys Himalayan sequence. And this main Himalayan thrust, it is not a smooth one, but smooth inclined one, but it has a steep slope at some places, and this steep slope part is known as the ramp. You must be knowing, and the gentle slope side is those are known as the flat one. So this ramp has a major role in the tectonic evolution of the Himalaya. When we see the surface view, we can see that the different tectonic zones are present, but more interesting is that we can see that above this lesser Himalayan metasedimentary zone, we have the higher Himalayan rocks which are present at the Nepe at some places, are also present as the Miss Klippe in some other places. And this this Nepe part, which is eroded away, they have this lower part is exposed, this one and this one, and these parts are known as the Indochon. So on the surface we have the Nepe, Klippe, Indochon. We have many types of many Klippes are there, like Almora Klippe, Ascot Klippe, Lansdowne Klippe, like that many Klippes are there. And also we have Indochon, particularly in the northwest Himalayas. We have two Indochons are there, very well known Indochons are there. One Indochon is the Kissar window that you know, and other one is the Kulu Rampur window. So here we have the different Himalayan zones are given here. From north to south and go Trans Himalaya, this part is the Trans Himalaya. Then this part is the Indus Sankalpachar zone, and this part is the Tethyan sedimentary rocks. And then from here, the South Tibetan detachment system till MCT, this part is known as the Higher Himalayan Crest Lines. And then between the MCT and MBT, that is the Lesser Himalayan Rocks. And towards south of this MBT, between the MBT and MFT, is known as the Sub Himalayan. So now I briefly talk the different tectonic zone of the particular in the Himalaya. I will not talk about the Trans Himalaya, but just I will talk tell you about the different parts of the Himalaya. This is first I will talk the Tethyan Himalayan sequence. This Tethyan Himalayan sequence, this light blue color, you can see this total, this light blue color is the Tethyan Himalayan sequence. And this rock type, the rocks which are present in this, it running in East Age, ranges from Paleo-Proterozoic to Eocene. That means before the rocks which were formed before the Himalayan orogeny, and rocks which are formed during the Himalayan orogeny, also those are also present in this Tethyan sedimentary zone. Here we have written already, I have given the rocks, rocks deposited during the pre-rifting, when the Indian plate was attached to the Gondwana land. That time deposition in the northern side of the Indian continent was going on. Then also that during the rifting of the Indian plate occurred during the Carboniferous Jurassic time. So during that time also sediments were deposited in this zone. And also we have after that also we have the passive margin sediment, passive margin was there. And in the passive margin we have the northern margin of the India, it was acting as a passive margin. So there also we have the passive margin deposition sequence are present, and then also the sediments were deposited during the Himalayan orogeny also. Those sediments are also present in this Tethyan sedimentary sequence. Now we come to the Higher Himalayan crystalline complex. This is very widely studied zone, and this pink color zone is the Higher Himalayan crystalline zone. So this is also present throughout the Himalaya, but here you see I have written that this zone is intensely deformed and highly metamorphic zone in the Himalaya, and it has metamorphosis up to greenish to amphibolite phases grade. And another interesting thing is that in this part we have the inverted metamorphic sequence. Inverted metamorphic sequence means at a low altitude we have the low grade. And at the high altitude, say, we have the high grade rocks. Low altitude means near the MCT, near the VT, near the Munsari thrust, we have the low grade metamorphic rocks. As you climb the higher Himalaya, then we can see the high grade metamorphic rocks. Here in this cross section, you can see here near this VT or MP, we have the low grade staurolite garnet grade metamorphic rocks are present. As you go inside the higher Himalaya, we are getting the high grade kyanite. Then the kyanite, sillimanite grade rocks are present, and when we go down towards the STDS, again we are getting the low grade metamorphic rocks. So at the high altitude we have the high grade, and the low altitude is the low grade. So that's why it is called an inverted metamorphic sequence. And this Higher Himalayan crystalline rocks is intruded by lithogranites of the Miocene age, that is around 25 million years old. Old granites are included in this Higher Himalayan rocks. This pink color, these are the lithogranites. Also, this higher Himalayan crystalline represents the broad shear zone. It is not the means just a simple rock, but it is highly shear rock that present in this zone. Next one is the lesser Himalayan sequence. Lesser Himalayan sequence. This light, this color, light green color, I would say. This color is this part is the lesser Himalayan sequence. So here we have non-fossiliferous low-grade metasedimentary rocks are present here. So here this and here we have also the permanent Cretaceous Cretaceous rocks which was overland this one. But in this part we have this Gondwana rocks are not present. But in the northeastern part, this Gondwana rocks are present. Overland and the Gondwana rocks are overland this lesser Himalayan rock. But here. Also, these rocks in this lesser Himalayan sequence, we have the metavolcanic, volcanic, and also organized rocks are present. You see, this one important thing we can observe about the lesser Himalayan metasedimentary sequence is that we can see when it goes towards the northeast, it is very narrow one. You can see this part; it is very narrow one, and as well as when it goes to this northeast side, it is narrow and present in the half window structure. But in this part, in the central part, particularly in the Kumaon Godwal and in the central part of the Nepal, we can see that the width of this lesser Himalayan metasedimentary zone is very wide. So that means this zone might have undergone intensive erosion. So that's why this erosion of the higher Himalayan rocks, which is associated above this one. So that's why we are getting the wide lesser Himalayan metasedimentary zone in this part. Now here we can see this lesser Himalaya is further divided into two zones. One is inner lesser Himalaya and another is outer lesser Himalaya. This dark gray color, light gray color part, this part is the inner lesser Himalayan rock, and this this part where I'm moving my this cursor, this part is the outer lesser Himalayan metasedimentary zone. This outer lesser Himalayan metasedimentary zones are the younger than the inner metasedimentary, and these both zones are overland by the overland by the clipae, which is rooted from the higher Himalayan crystalline rocks. This Almora clipae, Vaidyanath clipae, then the Ascot clipae, and this Lansdowne clipae. Those are thrusted above this lesser Himalayan metasedimentary zone from the higher Himalayan crystallines. Now we'll come to the outer Himalayan sequence. This is the youngest sequence in the Himalaya, I'll say, or we can say this sequence is deposited. These sedimentary rocks are deposited after the collision, and then I'll say after the during the exhumation of the higher Himalayan. Higher Himalayan crystallines. So here, this sub-Himalayan rocks are mainly made of Neogene rocks are there. And here, mainly two groups of rocks are there. Paleocene, Eocene, strata groups of these rocks are there, and also Miocene, Pliocene rocks are there. Paleocene, Eocene, these are the South Subatu, Dark Side, Kosoli. These rocks are mainly Subatu is there, and the Subatu rocks is of the Paleocene ten, and the Subatu is deposited in the marine environment, whereas this others on the Dark Side, Kosoli, and the Shivalik, those are deposited in the terrestrial environment. Now I'm coming with this brief geology background. Now I'm coming to the tectonic development of the Himalaya. How this Himalaya evolved, that I will talk now. So we can see this cartoon diagrams of the cross-sectional diagram of the Himalaya, and so I'll discuss one by one. So before collision, this Indian plate and Eurasian plates were separated by the Tethys Ocean. This part is the Tethys Ocean, and this Tethys Ocean was divided into two basins: Indus Basin, which was towards the India, and Siouxsie Basin towards the Eurasian. And this was separated by the island arc, and this island arc rocks are now we are saying the dross volcanics. by the brass volcanics, the Tethys basin is separated into two basins, Indus basin and Sioux basin. So in Indus basin, sediments from the mainly from the Indian continent as well from the island arc which are depositing, and in the Sioux basin from the island arc and from the Eurasian basin, the sediments are depositing. Of this Indian crust, it is not only the Indian crust is present along with this one. We have the Tethyan Himalayan sequence, which are older than this collision, collision one, and also the lesser Himalayan rocks are present. And within this lesser Himalayan, within this Indian crust, we have small marine basin. And that basin, people they say that is Subatu marine basin was present. So these are the situation before the collision. So this around 60 to 55 mm, the Indian plate and the Eurasian plate both came closer to each other, and then the collision started around 60 to 55 mm. So and when this collision took place, this Indus and Sujar zone was uplifted, and from this the sediments were transported and deposited in the Subatu marine basin, which was existing in the southern side, mainly in the lesser Himalayan rocks, in the south of the lesser Himalayan rocks. There we were deposited, and that is called Subatu sediments. So these sediments were deposited just at the time of collision. So that's why the Subatu basin, Subatu sediments are, this is the last stage of the collision. That's why we say this is the last stage of the collision, we say. So in the Subatu basin, the sediments were deposited just at the end of the collision between the Indian plate and Eurasian plate. And during this collision, another thing happened, that is this Ladakh Batholith, this pink color, this red color which has given inside the Eurasian crust, these are the Ladakh Batholith, those started included and placed within this Eurasian crust. Next we come to this next stage, that is 55, just after the collision, what happened. So during this collision, just after the collision, when this when it is still this collision technique is continuing, during that time this oceanic crust, which was abducted above this Indus Sankalpa Sujar zone, part of the oceanic crust is thrusted above the Tethyan sedimentary sequence. That means what we understand from this one, during collision, the thrust which were present in the Indus Sankalpa Sujar zone, those are dipping towards northeast direction, and because out of those thrust, this oceanic thrust is thrusted above the Tethyan sedimentary sequence. That is now we are saying the Kuntang Ophidite Clipper. So this is objected and thrusted above this one, and during this time also. This STDS, this South Tibetan Detachment System, which was formed in the just the southern boundary of the Tethyan sedimentary sequence, and at that time, the South Tibetan Detachment System was acting as a thrust. But now it is a normal fault. But at that time, during 55 mm. This South Tibetan detachment was acting as a thrust, and along this thrust, the Tethyan sedimentary sequence is thrusted above the higher Himalaya, and also mainly above the higher Himalaya. Then, during this time, also this sediments from this Tethys Himalaya, from the Indus Sankalpa Sujar zone, those are transported and deposited. In the lesser Himalayan metasedimentary zone, in the Indus zone above the Subatu sediments, above the Subatu sediment. But that time, this marine environment was not existing, and at that time it was the terrestrial environment. So, in the terrestrial environment, the terrestrial sediments are deposited, and that is named as dark side pumice. After that, what happened during during 27 to 5 mm, this is the main phase of the Himalaya. Here during this time, the major events in the Himalaya occur. first thing is what the first is that this during this time this MCT was developed, and at the same time the STDS is reactivated as normal fault. That time it, earlier it was the thrust fault, but during this time it is reactivated as a normal fault. So this STDS and MCT, these two both faults, those are acted synchronously during during this time 27 to 17 mm, and along this one this higher Himalayan rocks are thrusted above the lesser Himalayan metasedimentary. And because of this overloading of the higher Himalayan fist line, and because of the deformation, the intensive deformation, this higher Himalayan fist line is under the seen Himalayan metamorphism. During that, because of this rising of the higher Himalaya, the sediments from the higher Himalaya, some sediments from the Indo-Sankhya suture zone, some sediments from the lesser Himalayan sedimentary rocks, which are transported towards the south, and in the Indian side, this one basin was developed during this thrusting, during the synchronous thrusting, and in that basin, the shivalic sediments were deposited. So first, it's lower shivalic, which is deposited during the 16 to 12 mm, then the middle shivalic deposited during 12 to 5 mm. So these sediments were deposited. At the same time, the ramp which was present along this main Himalayan thrust, along this ramp also some movement occurred, and along this ramp some duplex structure is formed. And the duplex structure is now called lesser Himalayan duplex. So this is also formed, and in the front, then when the duplex structure was forming, at that time, this MBT was also formed in the front. So here, this in the MBT zone, we have the imbricate structure, and here we have the duplex structure. In the northern side, we have the duplex structure. In the southern side of this southern side, we have the imbricate structure along the MBT. Because of these two structures, the thrusted higher Himalayan fist line, along with the Tethyan sedimentary sequence, this was folded into thin form and syn-form and anti-form type of structure. So this anti-form part, it has uplifted more, and that part has exposed to rapid erosion. And whereas the syn-form part, it was not exposed to erosion, intensive erosion. So this part is eroded very less. So this antiform part, which was eroded away, that part is exposed at the window zone, and this part which is left, which is in the syn-form, which is left and which is not eroded completely, that part is left as clipping, as I have shown in the earlier in the 3D diagram. So this part is left as a clipping, and this part is exposed as window. So other places, in some places, this part is still what is joining with the root zone. So that time we are saying that napping. But when it is totally removed and it is no connection with the root zone, then we will say that it. So this time, these things also happen. Then I will see this higher Himalayan fist line. It has studied by the many geoscientists throughout the world. And also the different models have proposed, particularly for the higher Himalayan rocks. So here I am showing the three widely studied models. So first model is the wedge extrusion model. This model, it says that between the two faults, there is a South Tibetan detachment in the north or at the top, and main central thrust in the south. Both are joining in the southern side, and between these two faults, this higher Himalayan fist line is twisted out as a wedge. So that's why this is called the wedge extrusion model. Then the second one is called the channel flow model. So towards the Tibet side, high pressure gradient was developed, and whereas towards the southern side, the low pressure zone was developed. So this the liquid or partially melt material from the South Tibetan detachment, South Tibet, from the bottom of the South Tibet, they started moving towards the low pressure zone. And so that's why it is called the channel flow. So this way it is started going toward the south. Finally, it then flowed toward the south. This the southern part was uplifted, and there this when it is uplifted, orographic precipitation occurred, and this focus erosion in the frontal part occurred, and because of this focus erosion, overloading part it is eroded away, and now this higher magnification is exposed on the surface. This is channel flow model. I will show a small movie, an animation movie, how this channel flow was occurred in the next slide. This one is the tectonic wedge model. This model says that at the below the Tethyan sedimentary rock, there is a wedge, and initially above this wedge, the south along the South Tibetan detachment system, this Tethyan sedimentary sequence is perfect, and then later on, this higher Himalayan wedge, which is thrusted along the MCT, and next and then it is exposed on the surface. This is for tectonic wedging model. So now I'll show you this animation. You see this channel flow model, how it is happening. Here you have the high pressure zone. From the high pressure zone, the channel is flowing towards the south, and at the front we have the high topographic zone, and that zone has eroded away, and this channel is exposed on the surface. So this is called the channel flow model. Now we see we'll come to the present stage. At present, what is happening in the Himalaya? This is the last stage of the tectonic activity in the Himalaya, which is still continuing actually. During this time, when this higher Himalayan rocks are uplifted, clipe is formed, then the MDT also forms, all the structures are formed. This upper Himalayan sedimentary rocks are deposited above the Shivalik, at the top of the Shivalik. And during this time, MFT, main frontal thrust, was developed in the front of the Shivalik, the Shivalik sediment. And along this main frontal thrust, the Shivalik rocks were thrusted above the Indo-Gangetic. So this thing happened. Then another important thing happened. We can see this LHD, which I have already explained, the duplex structure. It was in this duplex structure. It is still growing actually. Because of this growth of this duplex structure, this MCT zone. MCT zone was actually, it is reactivated, reactivated. So some people are saying this is out of sequence thrusting. So after MBT, again this MCT is reactivated. That's why it is called out of sequence thrusting. So this is the tectonics of the Himalaya. So here you can see animation how this Himalaya has formed. You can see this one. So this way, this Indian plate has collided with the Eurasian plate, and then the Himalaya was formed. Now I will discuss the exhumation of the Himalaya. We have learned the geology of the Himalaya, and also the tectonics, what type of tectonics were going on during the different time, that also we have discussed. Now I'll discuss the exhumation of the Himalaya. So before I discuss the exhumation of the Himalaya, we should have the concept of exhumation. What is exhumation actually? We should know that one. Then I think we understand better how this exhumation of the Himalaya occurs. So when I say exhumation, exhumation is the upward displacement of the crustal rocks relative to the Earth's surface. I'm saying that particularly relative to the Earth's surface. With respect to the Earth's surface, the rocks, deeper rocks, how it is reaching to the surface, that is called exhumation. But this Earth's surface, which I am saying, that is not a constant surface. It changes. Once it's uplift, then when the erosion will take place, it will change. This our surface is changing, it is not constant. So then that means the our surface it is changing with respect to mean sea level. With respect to mean sea level, our surface sometimes it is rising, sometimes it is going down. So this way you can define exhumation is the rock uplift you have a minus surface of it. So in this cartoon diagram we can understand better. So here you can see this side, this y-axis represent the means elevation, and this x-axis is represent the time. So this A, B, C, D, these are the different blocks of the rocks actually present at the different depth. So here you can see this zero elevation. This is the mean sea level. So in the first stage, you can see that the surface is at 1 kilometer elevation, and there is a rock at the rock is present at where I have marked the star. So rock is present. So in this stage, we can say that this rock is present at a depth of 1 kilometer from the surface. So next stage, after some time, when this block has uplifted, now we can see that this block has moved to elevation 2 kilometer, and this rock it has moved to 1 kilometer elevation. But here we can see with respect to the previous surface, here this new surface it has uplifted 1 kilometer. Sorry. With respect to the mean sea level, now this surface has been uplifted to 1 kilometer, and this rock is also uplifted 1 kilometer. So you see, from the 0 to 1 kilometer, it has uplifted. So surface has also uplifted 1 kilometer with respect to mean sea level. Mean sea level here in the second stage, and rock has also uplifted 1 kilometer with respect to mean sea level. Mean sea level here, and it is now at 1 kilometer. So in this case, you can see when we say that how much exhumation is taken place of this rocks which is located at the star, then we can say there is no exhumation is taken place. You see, from the surface, the depth of the rock from the previous stage and in this stage at the same depth with respect to surface. So here we can say there is no exhumation is taken place. So when we consider in this equation, rock uplift 1 kilometer, surface uplift 1 kilometer. When we will deduct, then we will get a zero. That means in this case, zero exhumation is taken. Next, we will come to the third stage. Here, some part of this A block has now eroded away. That means 0.5 kilometers part of 0.5 kilometers of A part has eroded away. So this 0.5 kilometer eroded away. That means here we can say the surface uplift has taken place 0.5 kilometer with respect to mean sea level. But rock uplift, how much it has taken place? 1 kilometer. Surface uplift 0.5 kilometer, and rock uplift 1 kilometer. So here we can say the rock has reached towards the surface around 0.5 kilometer. So when we put in this equation, see surface rock uplift 1 kilometer, but surface uplift here you can see this is 0.5 kilometer. So when we deduct this one, then we can get 0.5 kilometer. So in this case, we can say the exhumation of this rock at the star has taken place 0.5 kilometer. The third, in the fourth stage, we can see this rock has now reached the surface. In this case, surface is at the zero, surface uplift is zero with respect to mean sea level, but rock uplift is 1 kilometer. So here you can say that rock uplift 1 kilometer minus surface uplift zero. That means rock. That means exhumation of the rock has taken place 1 kilometer. So like this, we can understand exhumation. So that means exhumation means how much part, upper part of the rocks has eroded away. That also we can say that exhumation. The part of the rock which will be eroded away, that much means exhumation of the deeper rocks has taken. That we can see. Now there are different process of the exhumation subject. One process is the normal faulting, another is the erosion, and third one is ductile thinning. So normal faulting, you see this rock is present at depth from the surface. When it is eroded away, now the rock has reached the surface. So this is tectonic, we can say this is tectonic exhumation also. here this erosion has no role because of the tectonics. This rocks has reached the surface. This is called tectonic accumulation. Then this erosion, then the accumulation can take place due to erosion. Here the rock is present is at this red dot, but when this upper part is removed, the rock has reached the surface. So here this tectonic has no role, but the accumulation has here this erosion has taken place, and because of this erosion, the rock has reached the surface. This is called erosive accumulation. There is another one due to the deformation, ductile deformation. The rocks can reach the surface. That is also a kind of tectonic accumulation. So here this thrusting cannot thrusting cannot be cannot be the reason for the accumulation. Thrusting plus erosion. When the thrusting will take place along with the erosion will along with the erosion, then only the accumulation will take place. What this thrusting is, thrusting does, thrusting uplift the rocks, and then erosion remove the rocks. Because of the uplift and removal of the rocks, then the rocks can accumulate to the surface. Then the here this here this thrusting the thrusting technique activity is not is not mainly sorry thrusting technique cannot only responsible for the accumulation. It requires erosion. Similarly, anti-form folding and doming also. So anti-form folding and doming also, it can uplift the rocks, and then on the surface, this erosion can remove the rocks, and rocks from the deeper part can reach to the surface. So these are different processes by which rocks can reach the surface. So here you see, I have already told that rock uplift minus surface uplift is equal to accumulation. When we say accumulation, we can say that we can understand the cooling. When once cooling will take place, that means the rock is reaching towards the surface, and once the rocks will reach towards the surface, the rocks will cool down. So the reaching the rock reaching towards the surface means accumulation. But it is very difficult. We cannot determine this rock uplift and surface uplift. It is very difficult. It is not possible because we require some other parameter. Require some parameter, geological parameter. Without that, we cannot determine this rock uplift and surface uplift. But we can determine this cooling. And once we determine the cooling, we can find out the accumulation. So this cooling we can determine by thermochronology. So this thermochronology, it is a study of the thermal history of the rocks, cooling history of the rocks. So this thermochronology, it provides the thermochronology provides the vertical motion of the rock's body with respect to surface over geological time. With time, the rocks will move gradually towards the surface, and towards the surface. Then that record we can determine by the thermochronology. So this thermochronology, it will provide us the nature of the uplift of the rocks and how much time has taken place to reach the rocks. These two things we can. These two things plus, along with this one, the surface process. By the surface, whatever process was going on, these three things you can find out from the thermochronology. From this one, nature is whether it was thrusting was going or not, or doming was there, or normal folding was there. That we can find out. And then how much time has taken place? How much time this for? Uplift has taken place, that we can find out, and at the same time at the surface how these rocks are removing, that we can find out. So these are the different techniques of the thermochronology. We can see on this graph, on this diagram. So we have many techniques are there. In the same rocks you can apply many techniques, but the suitable metal should be available. Then only you can apply all the techniques in one rock. Otherwise, you cannot apply all the techniques. Depending upon the what type of minerals which is present in the rock, we can apply different techniques. So, in our study, we have applied the fission track apatite and also the fission track circumstruct. These two techniques we have applied: fission track apatite and fission track circumstruct. You see this fission track circumstruct. And here it will give the cooling history from a depth at which this the temperature is around 250 degree centigrade. 250 degree centigrade. That means the Thyssen track Zircon clock start at around 250 degree temperature. So from 250 degree temperature towards the surface, it will record the time. Then like that, this apatite, it will record the temperature from from around 110 degree to the surface. So when the rocks will move from the depth of isotherm is 110 degree from that depth to the surface, the time required that will be recorded by this Thyssen apatite. So when we apply these two techniques to the same rock, we can find out from the depth of around 8 kilometers, that is 250-240 degree isotherm depth, to 110 degree isotherm depth, that is around 4 kilometers to surface. So we can find out the time record by applying these two techniques in our lab. Here you see these techniques which are like uranium lab zircon up to rubidium strontium moscovite. These techniques are known as the high temperature thermochromology, and the techniques from the rubidium strontium biotech to the surface, this is cosmogenic isotope technique. These are known as the low temperature thermochromology. That's why I have written this low temperature thermochromology study. So now I'll talk how we do the interpretation of the thermochromological data. Here you must have seen these diagrams in M.P. Billings structural geology book. So here this is normal fault. So in this normal fault, we have a sample in the hanging wall side and as well in the footwall side at the same depth. So after when this this hanging wall has eroded away, you can see this the sample has reached the surface in the hanging wall side, whereas in the footwall side the sample is still at the depth. It is at depth. So when we collect the sample across this fault, normal fault at different location in the hanging wall as well as in the footwall side, and when we analyze using the Thyssen track dating using the apatite and zircon minerals, we can see this. And when we plot this one, we can find this one. This side is age, and this side is distance. And here we have the fault. So you see this in the hanging wall side. What we are getting? We are getting this young ages hanging wall side, whereas in the footwall side we are getting the older ages. So hanging wall age means young age means you see the rock the surface rapidly compared to the rock present in the present in the hanging wall side. In case of the normal fault, this hanging wall has eroded away, and here you are getting the younger ages, whereas in the hanging wall side we are getting the older ages. So we can say that from this one, we can say that this fault was acting during this time, and due to this fault, this part has uplifted rapidly and undergone rapid accumulation or rapid erosion, whereas this part means it is giving the older ages, which has undergone slow uplift, or it has not uplifted, and it has and it is giving older cooling ages. Now we'll come to thrust type of thing. Here this is thrusting. Hanging wall has moved up and footwall has moved down, and after erosion we can see this situation. In the hanging wall side we have the rocks, and on you have the rocks, this rock is at the surface, whereas in the footwall side we have the rocks at the depth. When we collect the samples across this fault, we can see this type of plot. Here this is here age and distance. You see in this one, in the footwall side we have the older ages. Footwall has not undergone any erosion, or very less erosion has taken place, whereas the hanging wall side more erosion has taken place. Means rapidly from the isotherm of 240 degree or 110 degree it has reached the surface, whereas in the footwall side this the rocks have not uplifted rapidly from the isotherms of 240 degree or 110 degree to surface. Now we'll come to the strike slip fault. In case of the strike slip fault, the size lateral moment is there. So in this case, you can see that there is no change in depth after the erosion also. The depth is almost same in both hanging wall and foot wall. So when we plot here, we can see this graph like this, that in the foot wall side and the hanging wall side we will get same edges. So this from this we can say that this may be a strike slip fault. So fault. So that's why we are getting the similar edges in both hanging wall side and foot wall side. So this way we can do the interpretation of the thermochronological data. Based on this thermochronology, till now two models for the Pliocene tectonics of the Himalaya have been proposed. One model is called the duplex model, and another model is called the out of sequence thrusting model. These are the predicted model. Till now the study is going on. So this model or this duplex model, what is happening in this case? You can see one duplex is forming above the ramp structures of the main Himalayan pass. Because of this duplex, this uplifting is going on. So during this duplexing, this MCT is not reactivated. Remember this one here. I am saying the MCT is not reactivated. Only the duplex is active. But so because of this one, when will we determine the age across the Himalaya, we can get this type of pattern of the EFT edges. The yellow color represents the EFT edges, and the red color represents the ZFT edges. So you can see that just at the duplex structures, we are getting the younger edges, and away from the duplex structures, we are getting the older edges. Again, towards the MBT, we are getting the younger edges. So just above the duplex structures, we are getting the younger edges. And in case of the ZFT also same pattern, we are nearly same pattern, but it is quite different. But above the duplex structure, we are getting the similar pattern. But in the out of sequence thrusting, what you see here in this case, this MCT was reactivated as out of sequence thrusting after the development of the MBT or MFT. After development, this is reactivated. When it has reactivated, the higher Himalayan crystalline must have uplifted rapidly compared to the footwall side. So, because of this one, when we determine the age across the Himalaya, in this case, we get this type of pattern. You see that the broken pattern is there just across the MCT. This linear pattern of the FT edges and ZFT edges will be broken. So, you see this just in the hanging wall side, in the vicinity of the MCT, we can get the younger edges. And to inside the towards the hinterland side, we are getting the older edges. But in the footwall side of the MCT, we'll get this pattern. Towards the MBT, we are getting the younger edges. The difference between these two models is that here it is continuous one, but here it is broken one. Now I will come to the Himalaya. We know that this is geological map of the Himalaya. This Himalaya, in India we have the northwest Himalaya and northeast Himalaya. This part is the northwest Himalaya, and this part is the northeast Himalaya. We will not talk about the northeast Himalaya because we have the limited time. So I will talk about the Himalaya. This is the northwest Himalaya. So in northwest Himalaya, different parts studied by our group and by other different countries have data. Here on this, at the top of this map, this. The workers who have worked in different parts of the northwest Himalaya. Now we'll come to this northwest Himalaya. This is the satellite image of the northwest Himalaya. It is, and this is the geology Himalaya parts where the study has been carried out. Now let's come to Kashmir Himalaya. So Kashmir Himalaya means here we the study has been carried out in this one. This is called the this. This is the Kista window, the measurement box are exposed with the higher Himalayan rocks in the window structure. So your study has been carried out and your study has been carried out. So let's see what is happening here. Yeah. First we will see the window, crystal window. So this is the cross section of the across the crystal window. In the northern side we have the Himalayan rocks. In the southern side we have the crust, higher Himalayan nepe present, and we this one is crystal Indo-Eurasia. And this crystal Indo-Eurasia proposed on the duplex above the band. So this part is uplifted rapidly. This part is uplifted rapidly, whereas this part is not uplifted. And this yellow part, yellow part is the so important. We have the very small part of the lesser Himalaya. Already I have told that in northwest Himalaya, in the side, right, this lesser Himalaya is the only narrow one. So here it is very small. This part is there. So here when low temperature is carried out, it is found a very trend. You can see just how the we have the younger ages. This is this age, this is distance. So this is the younger ages, and as we move away from this core part of this window, we can see the older ages. So that means you can say because this because in the window this this duplex was growing rapidly, and because it's, the rapid growth of the duplex. This part is occupied. So, and it is exposed rapid erosion. So, that's why we are getting rapid erosion in this part. So, that means what I want to say is that this window, this far info is accumulating rapidly since the growth of the duplex structure. Next, we'll come to the Suru window. Suru window is this part. So in Suru window also you can see Suru dome. So Suru dome here we have the dome structure is there. The antiform type of structure is present here. So in this one the rapid erosion because antiform is there. So rapid erosion is taking place. Rapid erosion means we are getting the young ages, and as one moved away from this one we are getting the older ages. That means here I am what we have concluded that. That this dome area is accumulating rapidly, whereas towards the South Tibetan detachment site within the higher Himalaya, it is accumulating dome. Similar accumulation pattern we can observe in the another window structure. This is called Kulu Rampur, and this is present in Himachal Pradesh. Kulu Rampur window. So this Kulu Rampur window is present within the higher Himalayan rocks. So this Kulu Rampur, here also we are getting very similar pattern as this side. So here this graph is given. So in this graph, but the older ages are towards the origin of the graph, and younger ages is towards the top side of the graph. So this is just the reverse of this earlier graph. So at the core we are getting the younger ages. At the core of this window we are getting the younger ages. And here also you see these are the core, we are getting the younger ages, and as one move away from this core towards the limb, we are getting the older ages, both graph. So here also we are finding that Kulu Rampur window is also accumulating rapidly compared to the Jutub Nepe present in the south of it and in the north of this Kulu Rampur window. In Himachal Pradesh, in another area also study has been carried out, this area. So this is in the Chamba area, they carried out across this one, and this study has been carried out by the Chide group. So what they are getting that you can see this pattern close to the MCT. Here this MCT is there, this is a cross section, MCT is there, and then this dotted line is the MHT. But this MHT, if you see the structure, geometry of the MHT is very smooth. We do not have any ramp here. But in earlier cases, we have ramp type of structures along the MHT. So you do not have the ramp structures here. You have this rocks is present. Hemantha rocks are present. And here we are getting that near the MCT, we have the younger ages, and one move towards the hinterland, we are getting the colder ages. Older ages. So what it means? That means the, near the city, rapid uplift is going on, whereas the, in the hinterland side, no upliftment or very slow upliftment is going on. So this is interpreted like this: that near the city, the rock is, means the rock is means steeply uplifting, and means uplifting. Whereas inside this Himalaya or inside the hinterland side, because of the smooth MHT, rock is moving relatively more horizontally compared to vertical. So here the more horizontal moment is there. Horizontal component of the moment is dominating here, whereas this means here the vertical component of this uplifting is dominating here. So here the vertical component is more uplift, rapid uplift. So here you are getting the younger ages, and but inside this one, this horizontal moment is there. Horizontal component is more dominating, so less uplift. So you are getting the older ages. So in the Chamba region, just in the Delhousi part, Delhousi regions, we are getting the rapid uplift, whereas in inner side we are getting the slow uplift. Now we are coming to this Badwal Himalaya and Kumai Himalaya, where our group has carried out the study. So in this Badwal Himalaya, we have this higher Himalayan rocks. This is the higher Himalayan rocks. Then the Almora Klippe, the typical tectonic divisions, Almora Klippe. Then we have also Lansdowne Klippe, but most of the studies are confined in the higher Himalaya and in Almora Klippe. Both in the Badwal Kumai region also, the study thermochronological studies are confined in the Almora Klippe and in the higher Himalaya side. But very less studies have been carried out in the lesser Himalayan metasedimentary zone because this dating material rarely available or very or almost not available. That means this appertaining sequence are not concentrated in the lesser Himalayan metasedimentary rocks. So we are not getting many ages from the lesser Himalayan metasedimentary rocks. So from this we can see, first I am talking about the higher Himalayan rocks of both the Badwal and the Kumai. We can see this higher Himalayan thermochronological study of the higher Himalayan rocks of the Badwal Himalaya and Kumai Himalaya. You can see both graphs, both diagrams. Here this, you can see this trend is different. In the Badwal Himalaya, you can see close to the Berinak thrust, the Munsai thrust, Vaikrita thrust, ages are young. And as you go inside the higher Himalaya, the ages are older one. And this is true for both apartheid Thyssen trap and Zircon Thyssen trap. So ages becoming older towards the higher Himalayan rocks, and younger and ages are near the or in the vicinity of the MCT. But in the Kumai Himalaya, we can see that this age zone towards the inner towards the is visible now. Should I continue now?
Yes.
अभी आवाज थोड़ा ठीक से नहीं आ रहा है, क्या मिस क्या है अभी?
सर एक बार आया था लेकिन वापस चला गया।
आपने फोन में बात करी इसलिए कि आवाज नहीं आ रही है, दिक्कत हो रहा है।